working, as I've been told, the world a working days of old, when hearts were twice as good as gold, and 20 times as mellow. Good temper triumphed in his face, and in his heart he found a place for all the erring human race, and every wretched fellow. When he had Rhenish wine to drink, it made him very sad to think that some at jacket or at jink must be content with toddy.
With toddy must be content with toddy.
He wished all men as rich as he, and he was rich as rich could be. So to the top of every tree promoted everybody.
Now that's the kind of king for me. He wished all men as rich as he. So to the top of every tree promoted everybody.
Lord chancellors were cheap as frets, and bishops in their shovel heads were plentiful as tabby cats, in point of fact too many. Ambassadors cropped up like hay, prime ministers and such as they grew like asparagus in May, and dukes were three a penny. On every side field marshals gleamed, small bill were lords lieutenant deemed, with admirals the ocean teemed all round his wide dominion.
With admirals all round his wide dominion.
And party leaders you might meet in twos and threes in every street, maintaining with no little heat their various opinions.
Now that's a sight you couldn't meet, two party leaders in each street, maintaining with no little heat their various opinions.
That king, although no one denies his heart was of abnormal size, yet he'd have acted otherwise if he had been acuter. The end is easily foretold, when every blessed thing you hold is made of silver or of gold, you long for simple pewter. When you have nothing else to wear but cloth of gold and satin thread, for cloth of gold you cease to care, up goes the price of shoddy.
Of shoddy, up goes the price of shoddy.
In short, whoever you may be, to this conclusion you'll agree, when everyone is somebody, then no one's anybody.
Now that's as plain as plain can be, to this conclusion we agree, when everyone is somebody, then no one's anybody.
And now I have some important news to communicate. His Grace the Duke of Plaza Toro, Her Grace the Duchess, and their beautiful daughter, Casilda. I say their beautiful daughter, Casilda.
We heard you.
Have arrived at Barataria and may be here at any moment.
The Duke and Duchess are nothing to us.
But the daughter, the beautiful daughter. You're a lucky dog, one of you.
I think you're a very incomprehensible old gentleman.
Not a bit. I'll explain. Many years ago, when you, whichever you are, were a baby, you, whichever you are, were married to a little girl who has grown up to be the most beautiful young lady in Spain. That beautiful young lady will be here to claim you, whichever you are, in half an hour. And I congratulate that one, whichever it is, with all my heart.
Married when a baby? But we were married 3 months ago.
One of you. Only one. The other, whichever it is an unintentional bigamist.
Well, upon my word!
Who are these young people?
Who are we? Why, their wives, of course. We've just arrived.
Their wives. Oh, dear, this is very unfortunate. Oh, dear, this complicates matters. Dear, dear, what will Her Majesty say?
And do you mean to say that one of these monarchs was already married?
And that neither of us will be a queen?
That is the idea I intended to convey.
Oh.
Oh, Tessa, my dear, dear child.
Get away. Perhaps it's you.
My poor, poor little woman.
Don't. Who knows whose husband you are? And pray, why didn't you tell us all about it before they left Venice?
Because if I had, No earthly temptation would have induced these gentlemen to leave two such extremely fascinating and utterly irresistible little ladies.
There's something in that.
I may mention that you will not be kept long in suspense, as the old lady who nursed the royal child is at present in the torture chamber waiting for me to interview her.
Poor old girl. Hadn't you better go and put her out of her suspense?
Oh, no, there's no hurry. She's all right. She has all the illustrated papers. However, I'll go and interrogate her. And in the meantime, may I suggest the absolute propriety of your regarding yourselves as single young ladies. Good evening.
Well, here's a pleasant state of things.
Delightful. One of us is married to two young ladies, and nobody knows which. The other is married to one young lady whom nobody can identify.
And one of us is married to one of you, and the other is married to nobody.
But which of you is married to which of us, and what's to become of the other?
It's quite simple, observe. Two husbands have managed to acquire three wives. Three wives, two husbands. That's two-thirds of a husband to each wife.
Oh, Mount Vesuvius, here we are in arithmetic.
My good sir, one can't marry a vulgar fraction.
You've no right to call me a vulgar fraction.
We are getting rather mixed. The situation is entangled. Let's try and comb it out.